So good afternoon, everyone. As you are aware, we are into the chapter of third unit of actuating elements or actuators. And up till now, we have seen electrical actuators, in which we saw some of the DC motor configurations, brushless or motors with brushes. Then we saw some AC motors. We saw induction motors. We saw synchronous motors, and we also saw types of stepper motors. So all these electrical drive elements are used as actuating elements. If you just recollect, while starting off with the subject of mechatronics, if you try to recall the block diagram, we had various electrical block diagram. We had sensors, transducers, we had comparator elements, we had signal conditioning devices, we had A to D converters, D to A converters, we had amplifiers. So this sensed signal is conditioned as per our requirement, and this conditioned signal is sent to the actuators. So actuators can be mechanical actuators, they can be electrical actuators, they can be hydraulic actuators, or they can be pneumatic actuators. So this is how is the story. So, and after the actuation is done, we once again have the sensing and transducing elements, which will be sensing what is being actuated, what signal we are trying to control. If it is position, we will be having position sensors. If the parameter is temperature, then we'll be having temperature sensing transducers. So whatever is the process variable, we'll be accordingly having the actuating elements. And these outputs or the signals will be sensed by the sensor transducers, and then we'll have comparison either by using analog controllers or by using digital controllers like microprocessors or microcontrollers, where the comparison would take place and then the error signal would be generated, and this error signal would be once again appropriately conditioned, modified, so that that signal either amplified, either digitally converted, either analog converted, that will be fed to the actuators. The actuators then do the task of achieving the parameter, right? So in that series, in this unit, we have studied electrical drives or electrical actuators, and we have studied their characteristics. As a mechatronics design engineer, remember, friends, we need to analyze our requirements. If we take an example of maybe a robotic gripper, which is very much familiar to us, what kind of object I want to grip by using that gripper? How much should be the gripping force? What is the geometry of the object? And what kind of motion you want after gripping that object? Whether the object is to be placed somewhere, whether that placement of the object is crude, it is to be picked and placed. No matter if there is some inaccuracy involved in it, then we have to think of appropriate actuating elements. If my requirement is very precise, like I have a robotic arm which is carrying out maybe an eye surgery, then I have the instrument that is fitted or that is gripped by the gripper. And then it will be taken to the eye location, and there, with the help of course, ophthalmic surgeon, the surgery would be carried out. But here the positional accuracy requirement would be very higher. I require very high accuracy, and I require very high precision also. So depending on the application area, I need to select appropriate drive elements, appropriate actuating elements. Maybe the stepper motors, though they have some lower torque capabilities, but they provide me better positional accuracy. In some applications, I prefer stepper motors. If my load carrying requirement is higher, maybe I would go in for induction motors. I might go in for synchronous motor. I might go in for AC, two-phase AC motor. And if my speed control requirements are higher, then I might go in for a DC motor, either brushless DC motor or brush DC motor. So based on my application area, based on my parametric requirements, I should be, as a mechatronics design engineer, I should be able to select appropriate actuating elements. So last few classes we studied electrical systems. You must read the books so that you'll come to know, as a design engineer, what parameters I should look for, how I need to calculate the gripping forces, how I need to calculate the power requirements, how I need to design appropriate transmission elements. So I need to focus on that. So continuing that discussion regarding actuating elements, the second part of our unit 3 is study of some pneumatic drives and study of some hydraulic drives. So hydraulic and pneumatic drives, pneumatic drive, as you all are aware, those who have done diploma, they must have had a subject of fluid power engineering, or they must have studied hydraulics and pneumatics at their diploma level. And as you all are aware, where my cost requirements, if I want to have low cost automation, I prefer pneumatic circuitry. But if I want to have more reliability, if I want to have more power to be transmitted, if I want to have a smoother operation, I might go in for hydraulic circuitry. So hydraulic drives and pneumatic drives are very much actuating elements. Rather, if you see a DCP machine, you'll see use of hydraulic drives there for digging operation, for excavation or placing operation. So that is the best example of application of hydraulic drives. Whereas in low cost applications, like in a business industry, suppose I'm in a bakery, if I'm in a maybe a packaging industry, a milk packaging industry, probably you might visit Doodh Pandari, or you must have visited last year, I don't know. There also the packaging industry, I don't have any precise positional requirements as such. I need to have just indexing mechanism. I need to have some packing mechanisms. I need to have some holding mechanisms. I use pneumatic devices. So pneumatic drives are preferred. So based on my applications of application of my mechatronic system, I prefer either electrical drive elements or hydraulic drive elements or pneumatic drive elements. So let us see. Rather, we'll just brush up what are the pneumatic drive elements and what are hydraulic drive elements. Just to begin with, any pneumatic system need to have a pneumatic power supply, friends. If you just look at the diagram, it will have a pneumatic power supply. That means I should have conditioned pressurized air. Now, to get a pressurized air, I need to have a compressor, air compressor. Then for driving that air compressor, I need to have electric motor. Now, air compressor will be studying later. Either I'll be using reciprocating air compressor or rotary air compressors. Then once I compress that outside air, which is available abundantly in the atmosphere, I just suck it, I just compress it, bring it to higher pressures, and then I need to condition it. In a sense, because of compression, the air tends to be heated up. Now this heated air is cooled by using some cooling systems. Then this heated air might contain, or this compressed air might contain some moisture in it. So I need to have dryers in the path. Then I need to have pressure regulating unit as well. I need to have one reservoir and or receiver. I need to have some filters also if unwanted contaminants are there in the air. So in all, I need to have the filtering elements, regulating elements, lubricating elements. Because remember, friends, this compressed air will be sent through various valves to the pneumatic actuators. Those are mainly cylinders, if I want to have reciprocating motion. Or if I want rotary motions, I might go in for air motors. So that this compressed air needs to do some work further. It needs to actuate the cylinder. It needs to actuate the air motor. So there I need to have perfectly dry and lubricated air, because this air needs to help in lubrication of those pneumatic cylinders as well, as is done in our internal combustion engines. See, earlier internal combustion engines used to have petrol type of mixture. You used to mix oil in petrol, and then while combustion is taking place, all the piston rings are lubricated through that oil, which is just part of the product of combustion. So likewise, that fuel with oil, petrol plus oil, petroil, used to lubricate my sliding contact elements. Similarly, here what I do is, in pneumatic systems, I use a lubricating element. I use some lubricant which is added to the air. Then, so we call this as FRL unit. So filter, regulator, and lubricator unit. So the electric motor drives an air compressor. The inlet air to the compressor is filtered. It flows through a silencer, as you can see. So this filter silencer, so that noise reduction can be done. Then compressor, just at the suction port, it will suck. This compressor is driven by a motor. And then I have a pressure relief valve, right? It's a sort of safety measure, because this compressor will be building a pressure within the air. It will be increasing the pressure levels. So whether there is load on the external circuit or not, depending on that, I can set my pressure relief valve set to certain preset values. And then once that pressure is reached, the air is vented so that the accidents can be avoided, or the circuitry can be protected. Then we have a cooler. As I said, the compressed air tends to get heated up. It is to be cooled. Normally, it is water cooled. Then once again, you have filter and water trap. If water content is there, moisture content is there in the air, that is to be trapped, and then it goes to the receiver. So inlet air to the compressor is filtered, and it flows through a silencer to reduce the noise level. Remember, we are talking about pneumatic power supply. It's the compressed air generation, conditioned compressed air generation. Then we have pressure relief valve, provides protection against pressure in the system rising above a safe level. Now, since the air compressor increases the temperature of the air, there is a cooling system as well. To remove contamination or contaminants and water from the air, a filter with a water trap, we can call it as a dryer also. Filter with a water trap is used. Then finally, we have an air receiver, which increases the volume of air in the system and smooths out any short-term pressure fluctuations. So it does the work of smoothing out of the fluctuations. If you directly connect the output port of the compressor to my application area, so I might get a pulsating air supply. I might not get a continuous stabilized air supply. So I need an accumulator, or I need a receiver. So these are the elements of my pneumatic power supply. Let us see some of the compressors. Though we have done it in the earlier classes, we just brush up. So we have a single acting, single stage, vertical reciprocating compressor. So constructionally, it is similar to your internal combustion engine. Only thing is that the working medium is air. So we have the two ports, air inlet, suction stroke, and then in the compression stroke, it is compressed, and then it is this outlet valve will open up, and then the compressed air is stored in the receiver. So this is my single acting, single stage, vertical reciprocating compressor. So you must have seen double two-stage air compressor also, because if I want to rise the pressure in a single-stage compressor, I have a limit of increasing the pressure level to a certain value. In two-stage, I might use two cylinders, maybe inline cylinders or V cylinders, driven by the same motor. Then whatever compressed air I get from the first cylinder, that passes through the intercooler, and then it goes to the second cylinder. So the pressure level further rises. So that is the two-stage reciprocating compressor. The second variety of compressors is a rotary vane type compressor. You have the rotary compressor. So you have the inlet port wherein the air is sucked, and then we have the vanes, which are normally spring loaded, right? These can be compressed, these can be expanded or compressed, right? Or these can be extended or contracted, so to say. So as the rotary is rotating, the inlet air is trapped inside this annular portion, okay? And then as it rotates, the air is, so to say, churned out, and in the process, its pressure arises. As the rotor comes to the next position, these vanes will push that air to a constricted area wherein the pressure rises, and the compressed air comes out of this rotary vane type of compressor. And finally, we have a screw compressor. You have the intake port, and then you have intermeshing screws which have very small margin between these meshing or intermeshing screws. So through that constricted passage, the inlet or sucked air is allowed to pass through. Once again, it is churning out of air, and the pressure rises, and that high pressure air is discharged through discharge port. Now these intermeshing screws are driven by the prime mover, normally electric motor. So these are screw compressors where I get very high pressures developed. So reciprocating piston compressors, these are very important figures, used as a single stage compressor to produce air pressures up to 12 bar. As a multi-stage compressor, either two-stage or multi-stage compressor, I can rise the pressure up to about 140 bar. See, with multi-staging, I can raise the pressure of air to 140 bar. Typically, airflow deliveries tend to range from about 0.02 meter cube per minute free air delivery to about 600 meter cube per minute free air delivery. This is also, these two are very important parameters in case of pneumatic circuitry. What is the discharge pressure of air? And then what is the mass flow rate? This is the volume flow rate. We can always convert into mass flow rate considering the density of air that we are using. So we can get up to very high volume flow rate. So once again, how much is my volume flow requirement? How much is my mass flow requirement? Is all dependent upon my application. In certain drill rigs, if you have seen, I require a compressor, and then I require very high volumes of delivery air, because I need to continuously use the drilling rig. Borecha machines are done bagitla, that you have Atlas Copco compressors being used there, and you have very high volume flow rates and very high mass flow rates. Or in some industrial setups where I have very large loads to be catered to, maybe a pneumatic hammer I'm going to use in a forging industry or in a pressing industry. Normally, those are driven by pneumatic hammer is preferred in case of forging industry, but in case of press industry, because I want a gradual application of pressure, I go in for hydraulic drive or hydraulic circuitry in case of my sheet metal pressing operation. And maybe wherever impacting applications are there, you must have seen the air hammers being used for excavation. Tunnel karat astana, kiwa raste khodat astana, you must have seen the pneumatic hammers. So there also I require very high pressure, pulsating high pressure, plus I require higher mass flow rates of air as well. So free air is the term used for air at normal atmospheric pressure. Okay, so these are a few of the specifications of reciprocating piston type of compressors. Then rotary vane type compressor. It has a rotor mounted eccentrically. As you see, you have the rotor you have the rotor. So the rotor mounted eccentrically to the casing, right? The casing, the center is somewhere here, and we have this much eccentricity. So the rotor is mounted eccentrically, right? Eccentrically in a cylindrical chamber. This is a cylindrical chamber, right? You have seen just a sectional view. The rotor has blades or the vanes which are free to slide in radial slots, with rotation causing the vanes to be driven outward against the walls of the cylinder. As the rotor rotates, air is trapped in pockets formed by the vanes, and as the rotor rotates, so the pockets become smaller and the air is compressed. The compressed packets of air are thus discharged from the discharge port. The single stage rotary vane compressors typically can be used for pressures up to about 800 kilopascal with flow rates of the order of 0.3 meter cube per minute to 30 meter cube per minute free air delivery. So these are the specifications of my rotary vane compressors, rotary screw type of compressors. It has two intermeshing rotary screws which rotate in opposite directions. As the screws rotate, air is drawn into the casing through the inlet port and into the space between the screws. Then this trapped air is moved along the length of the screws, and the compressed air compressed as the space becoming progressively smaller, emerging from the discharge port. Typically, single stage screw rotary screw compressors can be used for pressures up to about 1,000 kilopascals. See the pressure, higher pressure ranges, higher discharge pressures with flow rates of about 1.4 meter cube per minute to 60 meter cube per minute free air delivery. So these are the specifications of rotary screw compressors. Let us see a few of the pneumatic circuitry details, so to say, right? Just animation. We have some basic principles. We'll just brush up. We first of all must see the pressure measurement. See, if I want to plot it on the datum level, you have the datum level, then we have atmospheric pressure from the datum or complete vacuum, and then we have the measured pressure. The pressure gauge is that measure is called as the gauge pressure, right? So this is my absolute pressure, right? And this vacuum pressure is below my atmospheric pressure. Below my atmospheric pressure, this is the vacuum pressure. Now, absolute pressure is the addition of atmospheric pressure and gauge pressure. So gauge pressure is the pressure indicated by the pressure gauge. Now, on the pressure gauge itself, there will be some atmospheric pressure that is acting. So absolute pressure, if we are interested in, that will be the addition of the pressure shown by the gauge plus the atmospheric pressure. Then we have the gauge pressure. So above atmospheric pressure, whatever is the pressure measured by, the pressure gauge is the gauge pressure. And below the atmospheric pressure, I have vacuum pressure, right? And this is the absolute pressure. Absolute addition of atmospheric pressure plus gauge pressure. This is the measured pressure. Pressure measurement, the units you know, 1 bar is equal to 100 kilopascal, which is equal to 100 kilonewton per meter square, which is equal to 14.5 pounds per square inch. You know, as a mechatronics engineer, as a hydraulics and pneumatics engineer, this should be very much known to us. 1 bar is equal to 14.5 pounds per square inch, because most of the gauges, because these are maybe mainly German made or European made, where they follow a foot pound inch system. So there we might find the gauges indicating PSI pressure. So what is the conversion factor? 1 bar is equal to 14.5 PSI or pounds per square inch. And we all know the pressure is force upon unit area. Once the force is applied, you are increasing the pressure, which is measured in Newton per meter square, area in meter square. The pressure inside a closed cylinder will increase as the volume decreases. This is what that figure says. As you can see the animation, if you apply the pressure, so this is the volume. When I apply the force, the volume decreases. volume, apply the force, volume decreases, the pressure rises. This is the compressive force. So what are the gas laws we should know? For a constant temperature, which is also called as isothermal process, for a constant temperature, the volume and pressure relationship will obey Boyle's law. What Boyle's law did? What Boyle's law states, we have studied it in our school days, maybe 11th class standard, we have studied Boyle's law. The product of pressure and volume is constant, or P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. That's what Boyle's law says. This means that if volume halves, volume ardha zala, the pressure will double, so that the product will be maintained constant. If the volume is halved, the pressure is doubled. If the volume decreases by a factor of 5, the pressure will increase by a factor of 5. Will increase. So this is what the Boyle's law says. The pressure properties of air, same thing. P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2, right? Initial volume V1, final volume V2, volume reduced, initial pressure was less, final pressure will be more. So that P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2, and P2 can be found out by knowing P1 V1 and V2. Okay. Flow properties of air also we need to know. We need to know Pascal's law is also equally important. Let us see. Right. So we have the supply air. What are the properties we need to know? Supply air. This is a constricted passage, maybe a converging and diverging passage, and I have a throat. Right? Sort of a venturimeter, you can see. You have a larger volume initially, then constricted passage of throat, and then once again larger volume. So whatever is the pressure here, the pressure is reduced here. Why? If you remember the Bernoulli's law, the energy remains constant. What is that energy? Pressure energy plus kinetic energy, right? And the potential energy. Potential energy plus kinetic energy plus pressure energy. The total energy remains constant. Or pressure energy, Bernoulli's law states that energy is conserved. Energy remains constant. What is this energy? Pressure energy, addition of pressure energy, kinetic energy, and potential energy. This will remain constant. If the pressure energy is increasing, kinetic energy will decrease. If the kinetic energy is increasing, pressure energy will decrease. Same thing is happening here. As the area is decreasing, what will happen? As the area reduces, the velocity increases. As the velocity of air increases, kinetic energy increases. As the kinetic energy is increasing, the pressure energy will decrease. This is what our Bernoulli's equation says. And what Pascal's law says, when there is no air flow, the pressure is the same regardless of the shape of the vessel, right? So wherever you mount, if I have got a cylindrical vessel, if I mount a pressure gauge on the side walls, if I mount the pressure gauge at the top, so at all the points, the pressure is equally distributed. This is what Pascal's law says. When there is no airflow for static air, which is pressurized, the pressure is the same regardless of the shape of the vessel. What do you mean? If I got a cylindrical container, then there is no flow. If I mount the pressure gauge at the bottom, if I mount the pressure gauge at the sidewall, if I mount the pressure gauge at the top, at all the parts, the pressure will be same. That's what Pascal's law says. So here, in the flowing fluid, in the constricted passage, as the kinetic energy increases, my pressure energy decreases. Once again, it is restored. Not to the same value because of the losses, the pressure will be restored. Earlier it was less, at the throat region it was less. Once again, as the area is restored, the pressure will be made higher. Because as the area increases, the velocity decreases, the kinetic energy will be decreasing. And as the kinetic energy is decreasing, the pressure energy will increase. This is what is the Bernoulli's principle telling us. Okay. So compressed air production, as we have seen in the first slide, we have the air receiver, where we have a pressure gauge, we have a temperature gauge, we have a safety valve, a pressure relief valve to safeguard my pressure vessel, so to say, or a receiver. Then I have a valve for taking that compressed air for my application. And then I have a drain. If the water is trapped, it can be drained. or the air after for maintenance, it can be trained. Then you have the compressor, reciprocating compressor, you have filter, you have once again the compressor shown here. So these are the elements of my compressed air production unit. The compressor, we have already seen the function of a compressor, right? We have the suction stroke, the air is sucked, and then I have a discharge stroke, the compressed air is. The compressor uses the gas compression principle to produce the high pressure air from pneumatic system, and there are many types of compressor. Common compressor is the piston type as shown below. Okay, this is what. Then the receiver. I think the next teacher is waiting for us. We'll stop for today, friends.